anything about biology, gotta be careful about diagrams. For example, view a circulatory diagram and you might think human blood can be blue or red, not realizing that human blood is red and the color coding used is showing oxygen concentration instead. Or see a diagram of a plant cell and suddenly you think all plant cells are boxy and all of them are not. Enter the chromosome. Diagrams for the chromosome have done me wrong too. For example, I remember often seeing chromosomes drawn in an X shape, so I thought, okay, all chromosomes are in an X shape. Which was really confusing when I heard about people having an X and a Y chromosome, because then I started to wonder, why are these chromosomes resembling the letters of the alphabet? And then sometimes they look like single stick pieces and not X shapes, and I wondered, what is going on with these things? I also thought that if in most cases humans have 46 chromosomes, then they're in there somewhere deep inside the body, that if you need to analyze them, you'd have to find them and make sure not to do anything to them because that's all you got. Didn't realize you find those chromosomes in nearly all body cells. So those were some misconceptions I had. We're hoping to clear those up and more about chromosomes. In this video, we're going to focus on eukaryotic chromosomes. And specifically, we're going to focus on human chromosomes. Chromosomes are made of chromatin, and chromatin is made of DNA and protein. A chromosome itself is really intense packing of chromatin. It starts with DNA being wound around proteins called histones. This forms nucleosomes, which are often considered to look like beads. More and more condensing packaging levels occur until it results in the chromosome level. But why all this packing? Well, in your cells, DNA has to fit inside a nucleus. It's also really important for when you make more cells, like in the process of mitosis. In mitosis, you have to be able to move DNA into new daughter cells. You have so much DNA that these highly packed chromosomal units make it easier to do so. It's important to remember that within the same human body, the chromosomes in one body cell are generally the same in another body cell. So, for example, if you were to compare a stomach cell and an eye cell in the same body, the chromosomes in those two cells are generally the same. Certain genes on the chromosomes may be turned on or off by a variety of factors. You wouldn't want your eye cells actively using the gene to produce stomach acid. That would be not ideal. By the way, DNA is not always coiled up tight. For example, in DNA replication, DNA typically needs to be unwound. There are a variety of factors that influence how tightly packed the chromatin is. Let's get kind of a general idea about how human chromosomes may be represented. Human chromosomes can be like this as a single component, or they can be replicated like this. This one has two identical chromatids called sister chromatids. When these two sister chromatids are attached, it's still considered one chromosome, but it has two copies. When these sister chromatids are separated, each sister chromatid can be called a chromosome. So this is a chromosome, this is a chromosome. In most cases in humans, each body cell has 46 chromosomes. In interphase, the DNA is copied, which will result in duplicated chromosomes. There's still 46 chromosomes here, but that's 92 chromatids in this picture. During a stage of mitosis, these 92 chromatids get pulled apart so that each cell will have 46 chromosomes. We have an updated chromosome numbers video to help clear that up a little more. And in our updated chromosome numbers video, we also mention more about the centromere, and we point out that you can recognize the term centromere as a traditional physical definition of a constricted region, as you've likely seen in diagrams that look like this, a region where the sister chromatids would be attached. But also, a centromere can be defined as a specific area of DNA and the proteins that bind there. Each of these sister chromatids technically have a centromere, which makes sense. I mean, these sister chromatids are identical copies. So you may also see diagrams that try to emphasize that. By the way, the centromere region, despite its name sounding like center, does not have to be in the center of a chromosome. So maybe you've seen pictures of all those human chromosomes before in a caption that reads, "Human karyotype." Karyotypes represent the appearance of an individual's chromosomes. The number of them, size, where the centromeres are. Cytogeneticists are examples of scientists that do karyotyping. It often includes placing isolated body cells, which could be from blood or body tissue, into a certain hypotonic solution. If you recall from our osmosis video about hypotonic and hypertonic, if the solution is hypotonic to the cells, that means the cells are hypertonic. Water is going to have a net movement into them, meaning the cells are going to swell with water. And that will help the chromosomes spread apart for karyotyping. The chromosomes can be stained and all the chromosomes can be identified and arranged. You can produce an image from this. To learn more about karyotyping and producing the images, please see our video description. The image itself produced can be called a karyogram. Just a note, it's common for many sources to use the term karyotype as a general term for both the description of the chromosomes and the visual image that may be produced and included. However, more technical sources tend to distinguish the visual picture as a karyogram, which tends to be produced as part of karyotyping. If a scientist is going to do karyotyping, which often will include a produced image along with it, the chromosomes need to be visible. Visibility is good. And that impacts when karyotyping is done. If you tried to take a karyotype during interphase, for example, that would be a challenge because you don't have that condensed DNA packing, that ideal chromosome visibility. For optimal viewing, a typical karyotype is taken at or right before metaphase. Recall from mitosis that in metaphase, each chromosome would have two joined sister chromatids. So if you search for karyotypes online and you come across differing images, maybe like these, remember a typical karyogram does have two sister chromatids per chromosome. It's just that many times the joined sister chromatids of each chromosome can be so close together that to an untrained eye, it can be difficult to tell. In the process of karyotyping, chromosomes can be arranged in homologous pairs. Homologous chromosomes are about the same size and contain the same types of genes, and within each homologous pair, you receive one chromosome from one biological parent and one chromosome from the other biological parent. In this general example of a typical karyotype of 46 chromosomes, you could see 23 pairs. 22 of the pairs, which would be 44 of the chromosomes, are called autosomes. This means these chromosomes are not related to biological sex. They may have genes related to eye color, or height, or hair texture. The last two chromosomes are called sex chromosomes because they are related to biological sex. Sex chromosomes are the chromosomes that get named X or Y. The name X and the name Y that are used for sex chromosomes have nothing to do with the shape of the chromosomes. The reason is an interesting topic to look up, though. In most cases, females have two X chromosomes, and in most cases, males have one X and one Y chromosome. But as we mentioned in our Punnett squares and sex-linked traits video, it is possible to have fewer or more sex chromosomes. More about that in our description. So in this example karyotype, 23 of these chromosomes are from a sperm cell from the male biological parent, a sperm cell which is a gamete. Unlike body cells, gametes have half the number of chromosomes as body cells. Sperm cells are considered haploid because they only have one set of chromosomes. The other 23 of the chromosomes came from an egg from the female biological parent. An egg is also a gamete. Egg cells are haploid because, like the sperm cell, an egg cell contains only one set of chromosomes. When a sperm cell and an egg cell combine, they form a fertilized egg known as a zygote. The zygote is diploid because it has two sets of chromosomes, and it will divide to continue to form more diploid cells. When it comes to sex chromosomes, generally females can only provide an X chromosome, as that's the type of sex chromosome they can give. And generally, males would have the ability to give an X chromosome, generally resulting in a female baby, or a Y chromosome, generally resulting in a male baby. Because sperm cells can carry an X or a Y chromosome, this is why males are considered to determine the biological sex of the offspring. Interesting fact to add about the Y chromosome has a gene on it called the SRY gene, which stands for Sex Determining Region Y. And it is a gene that, when expressed, triggers the development of male biological characteristics. So why do karyotyping? Why have detail about a person's chromosomes and also have it visually shown? Well, it could be for medical screening, for example. There are conditions where an individual may have more or less chromosomes. For example, 47 chromosomes or 45 chromosomes, or individual chromosomes themselves could have missing or extra segments. Karyotyping can reveal this. Do you have an interest in a career that involves this area of study? The field of genetics continues to expand, and the career of a genetic counselor may be something to read up on. Well, that's it for the Amoeba Sisters, and we remind you to stay curious.